and I graduated 3 years ago with a BFA in illustration. I don't know who normally gets to present, but I am not famous yet. I'm not published, not in a TV show or a movie, but I feel like I have some advice for anybody who's graduating soon. Just a quick question, who is graduating like this after this year? Seniors? Oh, awesome. Cool. And then juniors? Oh yeah, like the clump over there. And then any under, like sophomore, freshmen? Wow. Okay, cool. Thanks for coming, guys. Well, hopefully my advice is for everybody here. I am talking really directly towards those soon-to-be graduated students. First, I'll just kind of talk about myself a bit. Why am I here? I have a BFA in illustration. I'm freelancing full-time, fairly successfully. I mean, it's like up and down, as expected. And I'm here to give some advice from the heart. I've worked a lot of jobs, a lot of different jobs. I started immediately working for Sharpie Markers in Oak Brook. I'm sure you all are familiar with like Prismacolor or like Expo or Papermate. It's all the same company. So I did a little work for them. I currently work at Bottle and Bottega, if you're familiar with the Paint and Sips, probably around Chicago and the suburbs. It's fun. It is really fun, and I feel like I've learned a lot about public speaking there and how to paint better. We work with a lot of companies like McDonald's, Southwest Airlines, different like State Farm. That's really great exposure. And then I do freelance. I did a job for Sierra Mist where I got to paint on a mural for their new billboards going out for their logo. And I do some book covers for a self-published author. Which, I mean, books don't sell, but he still calls me, so that's what's important, right? So I wanted to also talk about galleries. Is anybody like fine art major? Like five of you, cool. Illustration, I'm sure like everybody's hands go up. One? Oh, okay, yeah, don't be so shy. Galleries are great for, I'd say, definitely the fine artist, the illustrators. I have an illustration degree, but I definitely lean towards more fine art. So some galleries that I think you guys should check out that take young artists are the Lee Gallery in Lakeview. They are awesome. It's right on Halstead, super like happy art. She won't take any of my skulls, none of my snakes, just like pretty much all my portfolio, but like happy stuff, landscapes, trees, and flowers. Chicago Trueborn, has anybody heard of Chicago Trueborn? Yeah, awesome. They are, well, it's one girl, Sarah. She runs the place. They actually have an opening coming up this Saturday, the 12th. And it's not the West Loop, it's actually in Wicker Park. But they take a lot of young street artists. It's a lot of like urban art. So if you're into that, I would definitely find them on Facebook and give her a shout out. Say, hey, like, I'm a student, doesn't matter how old you are. If you've got a strong piece, send her a message. Fortunate Discoveries in Lincoln Park. I've never sold anything there, but I'm in there. She represents me. I don't know why, but it's good to be spread out everywhere. That's what I'm trying to get at. There's places in the suburbs if you want to be represented in a gallery. You're never too young to be taken seriously. And if you take yourself seriously, they will too. So one last thing I want to talk about was state of the art. I know I always blow up Facebook if you follow me at all. About state of the art. They are a pop-up art show that goes around all of Chicago. So the last show I did was in the Loop, and it has like a different vibe everywhere you go. The show before that was in Wicker Park, and that was super fun. Danny, I don't know if you guys know Danny Torres, he's fantastic too. He's been to those. but yeah, that's some of the stuff. There's gonna be like little tidbits of advice throughout this whole presentation, so. Freelance. A lot of you, no matter what your degree is, you'll probably start freelancing, just like I did. I started basically doing pet portraits. That's what I advertised. Hey, get your pet done for Christmas, or have your family done for Father's Day. You know, those are like some good cliche things an illustrator, fine artist can do. Even like a photographer doing family photos, wedding photos. It's a great way to start. So I want to talk about my recent stuff, which I'm doing like a lot of fan art. And I bet like a lot of you probably like fan art too. I didn't start doing fan art until maybe like 3 months ago. But I love it. And the reason I love it is because people identify with what they're familiar with. When you go to, let's say, a concert, you don't know the band, but then they play a cover song, you instantly start singing along. And I feel like it's got the same thing for art. People might not know who you are, they might not know your art, but if they see you painted like Harry Potter, and they love Harry Potter, they're gonna like it no matter how good or bad the painting is. So, fan art, super popular. This was a commission for a guy out in Milwaukee. He wanted like a whole movie room of villains, so these were his ideas. They were all supposed to be like the same, just 2 of 5. And then I've done some fantasy art from Zelda, which I don't own a game console, but the guy wanted 2 paintings of castle and like fantasy area. I don't know, I kind of made it up with like a castle, but he wanted like sunset and a waterfall and a lake. And even though you're talking to a client, they're telling you what you want, you still get to make it your own. This is something recent. And then Star Wars. Star Wars is like huge right now, it's coming out. I just got picked up by an art distributor called Twin Suns Outpost, and it's a brand new company, just started. So if you're into Star Wars and you do a lot of Star Wars art, you should definitely come up to me at the end of this. I'll give you some contact info for Twin Suns. He only has like 7 artists right now, and this stuff is like just emerging. He basically asks me, hey, can you paint Yoda for me? And he'll buy out the rights to my work, distribute it for me. I make 70%, and he does all the promotion. He's got a website, he makes the prints, everything. All you are responsible for is creating the art. And I've done 6.5 paintings for him, or 7.5. I'm working on Boba Fett right now, but it's huge. This is what my portfolio has been for the past 3 months. I've hardly done anything for myself. It's been just tons of fan art. Back to freelance, still on freelance. I recently done a job for Marriott. It was a random job. I got the job through Facebook, actually. An acquaintance of mine hooked me up with a friend of his who worked at Marriott. Their artist bailed on them a week and a half out from the deadline. They just needed 5 words drawn or typed, which seems like no big deal, right? But because it's corporate, you know, they want to have a lot of revisions and stuff like that. But I was able to pull it together in a week, send them this. I even had a hookup with the printer. So that was a really cool job. Things kind of just like pop up. You just got to say yes to whatever comes your way. I'm sure, are there any graphic designers in the room? Just curious. Yeah, you're probably like cringing at this, I apologize. I am an artist, like an illustrator, fine artist first. I am not a graphic designer, and when the job came to me, I was terrified. I didn't sleep for like 2 days because thinking to myself, oh my gosh, I really don't know what I'm doing. But I said yes anyway, just to learn from the experience, and it ended up being a fine experience. But that's another piece of advice. Even if you're not super comfortable doing a job, try it out. You know, if it's low risk, give it a try. You might learn that you like it, just like I did for fan art. I had no idea what I was doing. I actually had never seen Star Wars until I started doing the paintings. So just a piece of advice. This is, okay, so Grace for Society. The guy that I do these book covers for, his name is Alex Siegel, and he's a self-published author, really like promoting on his own, and it's hard to explain. Okay, so he wrote all these books for Grace for Society, it's a series, and the artist he had before he had me was a self-taught painter, and he was doing all these book covers in like oil paint. They were all the wrong dimensions. He was hand writing the font for everything. Like, the guy had no design experience. I guess he just kind of fell off the face of the earth, and the self-published author came to me, asked me if I would fill in. I was just out of college. It was like October of the year I graduated, and I've had him as a client ever since. It's been 3 years, and it's good to maintain relationships with clients that you start jobs with. So like, let's say you're in college now and a guy comes to you, wants you to do band art for him. Maybe it's a guitarist, he wants you to do his work for him. try to keep him as a client for a while, because that's consistent work. It's something you can rely on for a long time. And it might only be like 3 or 4 paintings a year, but you can kind of guarantee like, oh yeah, he's gonna come out with 3 books. I can do like an inside cover and 2 fronts or whatever. You never know. So this is just some of the work that I've done for him. And then Sierra Mist. So the way that I'm not gonna talk much about Sierra Mist, I'm gonna talk about how I got the job. It was actually, it started with an assignment in portfolio classes. Nobody's in portfolio yet, right? Because that's like second semester. Okay, so when you get into portfolio, I don't know if this assignment still exists, but you have to do like a small freelance job and do a write-up on it and then present. And I decided to go on Craigslist and to see, type in like artist needed. And it turns out that this company called Mosaic was looking for an artist to draw on the Samsung Galaxy Note tablets. It was like a brand new phone. I'm sure actually some of you probably have one. It's like a huge tablet phone. It's kind of ridiculous, but it comes out with this S Pen, and they're trying to demonstrate how easy it is to use this phone with this S Pen stylus. So I applied for the job, I get it. What I'm doing is I'm sitting in Woodfield Mall, taking pictures of people's faces and tracing them on the phone to show like, hey, you could be an artist too. I must have made a great impression because the girl who was in charge of Mosaic, in charge of hiring, remembered me. 3 years later, she's contacted by an ad agency in New York saying, hey, we're doing a job in Chicago. We need one female artist. We've got 4 males. We need to have it a little bit more rounded out. Do you know any girls that paint or draw? I was the only name she submitted. Honestly, I had no idea. I didn't even remember her. But we... She's really sweet. She gave my name, and then boom, I got the job. It was a really great experience. I was the youngest on the team. It's definitely a little intimidated, a little scared, but I mean, everybody was pretty great, and it was a cool opportunity through just a random chain of events that happened. It is important when you get a client or you get a job, just to leave a good mark, be friendly, be nice, do your work on time. It's all those basic things. People would rather have somebody dependable than like spectacular. So, work, work, work. Who works now? Like, if you have a job, yeah, a lot of you are saving. Wow, oh my gosh, so many. Hope you're doing your homework. I also worked. I was a hostess in Oak Brook. It was a horrible job. but I wanted to leave, so I decided the easiest way to get out of hosting would be to get a 9-to-5 in the art field, which is what I did. I got a job with Sharpie. I started as a freelance artist. I was actually working for free. When I say freelance, literally, I was not getting paid. And then it turned into an internship later once I proved myself. But it was a hard realization. I figured out I hate the 9-to-5. I'd rather be home working in my pajamas, which I'm sure a lot of you probably feel the same. I was with Sharpie for about a year and a half. A lot of work for them. It was a fun environment. It was cool. It was still corporate, but it was working for the man, and I decided that was not going to be for me. So I ended up leaving in like June of the year after I graduated, and I went back to the restaurant because I was scared. And then I got a phone call from my savior. That was my mentor, Dodie Mondero. He's a muralist, he's an illustrator, he does a lot of stuff. He asked me if I wanted to intern for him, if I wanted to be an apprentice as a muralist in Naperville, which is very cool. I got my start, got my interest for acrylic painting, which I had never done at all. I'd always done ink and watercolor, Sharpie markers, like that was my thing. But it made me more comfortable with a new medium, and that got me my job at Bottle and Bottega, which is where I currently work. I'm a studio manager there, and I teach occasionally. I've actually cut down to 2 days a week now because freelance has picked up, but it's taken 3 years just to get some consistent work coming in. But working at Bottle and Bottega really helped me with public speaking. I remember my first class, I had like 6 people in it. I was so scared. I was like dripping from sweat. I totally forgot to give them aprons. I thought I was gonna get fired. And now I teach there like 3 times a day that I work there. So it's great. If anybody is interested in becoming like a paint and sip instructor, if you're just trying to get some like hours freelancing, my boss in LaGrange, it's in LaGrange, my location. It would be very interesting in hearing from you. There are locations in Evanston. There's one that just opened up in Arlington Heights. And then there's a South Loop and Glen Allen. So are interested at all. There's also like Vino Van Gogh and Pino's Palette. I mean, there's so many like kitschy names, but Bottle-O-Tag is obviously the best. So that is not a 9-to-5. That is something that I pick my hours. I'm contracted technically, so I get paid every week. Some locations even pay after the day you've worked. So you kind of tell them like, hey, I want to work Tuesdays from 6 to 9 and Friday all day. And that's when you're scheduled. So this is great for somebody who doesn't like to work that typical like wake up at 8, do your thing, go home, hate your life. It happens. So I know the faculty probably wanted me to talk a little bit about social media and streams of income. Looking at you, Tom, about streams of income. Yes. That was probably the best advice I ever got from you, was all the things.
When we weren't fighting?
Yeah. Having many like venues of income. So, for example, maybe you do work at a restaurant right now. You've got like a little bit of money coming in there, but you've started to do some freelance. So maybe you're doing some pet portraits, some family portraits. You've opened a Society 6 or a new Vango. You've got that going on. Maybe you were lucky enough to get in a gallery. You've got that. So now you've got like 4 streams here, and they're all making little bits of money. Combined, that can be a huge chunk. So when you spread yourself out, it ends up giving back to you a lot. So that's what a stream of income is. Social media, everybody knows about social media, whether you hate it or love it. I don't love it all. I am a fan of Facebook, and I am horrible at Twitter, and I don't have a Tumblr anymore, but Instagram's okay. So I have like the 4 main, there's a million platforms, but the 4 main platforms. There's Facebook. I feel like it's condensed and unified, especially if you have a fan page. I have a page just for art that I try not posting too many selfies. But there's also like no distractions, so you're not posting pictures of your dog or, you know, Danny. Instagram, I haven't mastered Instagram yet, but I feel like it's great for shout outs. So if you've got a buddy that's got like 2,000 followers, maybe you only have like 200, you want to like exchange a shout out, like, hey, I'll give you a shout out to like lead to my page, you give me one. And that's how you can gain some followers there. Twitter, as I mentioned, I don't understand. And Tumblr is awesome, and I don't give it enough credit, really, but like Marco Mazzoni, if you've heard of him, I think his website is just a Tumblr page. I don't really think he has like a professional website. It's free, it's just streams of images. Tumblr is actually a really viable way to show off your art. I don't think it's as concise as like, say, other people's pixels might make it, or if you design your own, but still, you're on a budget. Tumblr's great. Now, because I'm a huge fan of Facebook, I thought I would talk a little bit about promoted posts. So over the past couple years, Facebook's really screwed over businesses, small businesses, and people who have their own fan pages. They only give out 10% of your art or work, whatever you do, to your fans. So if, let's say, you have 10,000 fans, only 1,000 potential people will see your post. And then the other 9,000 aren't gonna ever get a glimpse unless you pay for it. So a promoted post gives out more, just puts you on their newsfeed, basically. So I've got my image that I wanted to promote, and I press boost, which actually I could probably pull up. I pulled up my Facebook if you guys were interested in seeing how to promote a post if you haven't done it already. But it's not expensive. I mean, you can do it for like $3. I usually do $5 and then I stop it after 2 if I can see, you know, oh, only like 100 people have seen it and I've already spent like $3. I'm going to stop the post because it's obviously not working that well. But you can pick out who your target group is. And I usually just do people who like my page and their friends. Tends to be more trustworthy. If I see Danny has liked something, I'm probably going to be more invested than just like it popping up on the side. You can say what age. I usually leave it pretty open, but you can narrow it down if you want. Gender, male and female, and location. My main 3 are UK, Mexico, and US. I feel like Mexico is good for me because I do a lot of skull art. I tend to get a lot of following from there. Actually, I'd say probably 50% of my following is in Mexico. and then you can say how much you want to spend. So this boost spent all of my $5, 8,000 people saw it, and 354 people acted on it, whether that's a comment, a share, or a like. So it really breaks it down. You can go even further into it and see the breakdown, but at the end of the day, you know, organically, only 1,000 people saw this, and I have 10,000 followers. That sucks. That's horrible. People always ask me, how did you get so many followers? Well, it's through promoted posts. I've had to pay for it. I'm not paying for fake likes. These are real people, but you gotta work for it a little bit. So the reason that I stay with Facebook is because most of my commissions, my jobs, they have come from it, whether it's people, acquaintances from high school who have been like, oh yeah, you drew, right? Can you draw my dog? Or I've got a friend, they wanted something done. I would say 100% of my commissions this year have been from Facebook. I can say that pretty confidently. New Vango in Society 6. If you've got like a hefty portfolio at this point, you could totally get on there. Even if you're a freshman and you've got some work, that's great. You should totally actually try doing some Society 6 stuff. They don't judge you to get on. You can open it immediately. The pros to it is there's nothing, you don't have to do anything. It's not Etsy, you don't have to ship your own stuff. You just have to paint and then post it. There's no down payment. It's easy to promote, just attach a link. They do coupons all the time, and then there's a variety of crap you can do. So like iPhone cases, shower curtains, whatever. The only con to it, to Society 6 specifically, is they only give you 10%. So for example, I just posted, I think it was like yesterday or 2 days ago, like, hey, coupon, Society 6, buy a mug. I sold 4 mugs. I made $1 each mug. And it's like, cool, somebody bought my stuff, and I made $4. It's a downside. So New Vango, I don't think they're actually taking any applications right now, but when they do open up, they give you 20%, which is way better than 10. I know math is probably not our strong point here, but just trust me. So 20%, and they pretty much lay it all out for you. With Society 6, you do have to like mock up your own stuff. New Vango's good. The only thing is they don't have as much promotion as Society 6. So takeaways for today, just keep making art. That's really all you need to do, because when you do it, people realize, oh, you're an artist, you can do something for me. That's all I've done. I just paint every day. I paint all day. And I'm sure if you love it, you do the same thing. So that's like the most important. If you wanna contact me at all, I'm on Facebook, I'm on Instagram, and I just opened Etsy. So if anybody's on Etsy and wants to give me some pointers, hope I didn't bore you, and I hope you learned something. But if you have any questions, let me know. If you want to see anything on Facebook, I've got my Facebook open. So yeah, don't be shy.
Questions, anybody? You were so thorough. To have any questions?
Yes.
Have you tried Pinterest?
Yes, I love Pinterest, but more for like hairstyles. No, you don't. Actually, it's like 17 and older for like people who attend. She did ask if I had a degree. I did. Most everybody else is a hobbyist. So, I mean, as freshmen, and I know the people who come here, like, you guys are better than some of the people I work with. And that's just, I love my coworkers and my family, but I know the potential that the school has, and that's why my boss was like, really, push it. So, yeah. Yeah, I'll be back there.
Yeah, I'm just curious if you're doing, like, freelancing or commission work, how many clients, like, do you have? Like, do you have, like, supposedly, like, you know, a certain amount? So, like
a month?
Like, I'm just curious, like, if you're doing, like, commission artwork or freelance, like, do you have, like, a limited amount of, like, of clients that you can work on?
The question is, do I have, like,
can you have, like, a limited amount?
Oh! I mean, I have, like, a goal. for clients. I have probably three or four consistent clients, and then I get pop-up clients all the time, people who want like a one-off thing. But I have a list. I have a contact list that I keep, like email, like any job I've ever done, even if it was one thing. And I include them on like an e-blast, and I try to maintain them. But my goal every month is to have like 4 big commissions, or try to do some like sales. But yeah, I don't know if there's like a limit. I accept every job. For example, I was in the middle of like 3 commissions at once, and a friend of Danny's contacted me and said, "Hey, can you do a t-shirt design for me?" He's a startup. Basically did it very, very cheaply, and I did it in a day for him. I said, "Yeah, let me drop everything and just do it," because I mean, it's either that or watching Netflix. So might as well do both. Yeah.
What's the name of the one you're talking about?
Twin Sons Outpost.
Twin Sons Outpost.
Twin Sons Outpost, yeah. He's a really cool guy. He's out in Gurnee. He's just like a really avid Star Wars collector. I've been to his house. His house is a museum for Star Wars figurines. He's the largest collection in the Midwest. Literally, each door has like a plaque above it saying, you know, figurine room or like broken merchandise. It was an interesting experience. Felt a little claustrophobic, but what a great guy and what a great contact. So he has all sorts of different artists: pencil, acrylic, digital, a lot of digital stuff. Yeah, he said also like, "Hey, drop my name." Spam.